slot, 10 minutes.
Thank you, Cathaoirleach, Arlas Gancorla. I'm glad to have the opportunity to speak to this bill today. The bill merits careful consideration in all of its aspects. As most of you will know, I have addressed this bill already in the Senate, and I won't therefore repeat what I've already said about my activities on the issue of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. I hope that deputies will recognise the priority that I have attached to this issue and the time that I've devoted to it, and indeed the public funds that I've committed to it in the context of support for the Palestinian Authority and UNRWA in recent times. This has included three visits to the region in my first 12 months as Minister for Foreign Affairs, work on the political process, on Gaza, and keeping up consistent pressure at EU and international level against the expansion of settlements. Ireland has also been to the fore in shaping EU policies on settlements, including the exclusion of settlement products from normal tariff levels, preventing EU research funding being spent on settlements, preventing misleading labelling on settlement goods, and providing for the specific exclusion of settlements from future EU agreements with Israel. Ireland also supports Israeli, Palestinian and international NGOs which defend Palestinian communities under threat from settlements. No member of this House attaches greater importance than I do to bringing Ireland's influence to bear to help end the occupation of Palestinian territories, to promote a two-state solution that works for Israel and for Palestinians, and to deliver a sustainable peace after decades of conflict. However, speaking on behalf of the government, I do not agree that this bill is the right way forward now. I wish to set out carefully for the Dáil why this is so. There are three broad reasons: legal, political and practical effects. The overriding points that frame the government's view is that this bill asks the state to do something that is not within its power. Ireland is part of a single unified EU market. Trade is an exclusive competence of the European Union, and everybody who is informed in this House should know that. We are not in a position to raise a barrier and declare that it is prohibited to bring to Ireland for sale or personal use goods which enter the EU legally and are freely circulating elsewhere in the single market. This is the meaning of the single market, the defence of which is something which the EU takes very seriously, as we've seen in the context of Brexit. The integrity of the single market is in Ireland's overall interests. The formal advice to the government of the Attorney General on this matter has confirmed clearly that passage of the bill would put Ireland in breach of EU law and expose Ireland to legal action by the European Commission as guardians of the treaties. Some supporters of the bill have put forward legal opinions which highlight a public policy exemption, which states that provisions on free circulation of goods do not preclude, and I quote, prohibitions, quantitative restrictions or surveillance measures on grounds of public morality, public policy or public security. However, I am strongly advised that the European Court of Justice has shown in previous cases that it will not allow the terms of the quote that I've just outlined to be interpreted broadly. A broad interpretation of the public policy exemption would so obviously have implications for the EU's exclusive competence on trade that it is entirely foreseeable that a challenge by the European Commission would follow. Our informal soundings do indeed lead us to consider that extremely likely. And should Ireland be found to have breached EU law, as we expect, the state would be exposed to potentially very significant fines, as well as legal costs. Fines recommended by the Commission in such cases can include lump sums of over €1.5 million plus daily fines. Cumulative annual costs of these fines can range from hundreds of thousands of euros per year at the lower end of the scale up to tens of millions of euros per year at the higher end. No government, nor any responsible opposition in my view, could support intentionally breaking EU law and exposing the state to such significant penalties. The bill could also be challenged by companies or individuals claiming to be adversely affected by it, And in addition to legal costs arising in these circumstances, a finding against Ireland in favour of a private party could give rise to damages being awarded against the state. In addition, costs would arise for the relevant authorities in the implementation of the law, which would create new offences, the investigation, enforcement and potential prosecution of which would have resource implications for the customs authorities, an Garda Síochána and the criminal justice system more broadly, including perhaps even the prison service. Additional costs will also arise from voted funds for certain Irish diplomatic missions abroad, should this bill be enacted in our view. I should state clearly at this point that because of these costs across a wide range of areas, there can be no doubt that the bill will require a so-called money message in order to proceed to committee stage. I should also mention briefly some other legal and constitutional difficulties identified with the bill, including the use of ministerial regulations to extend the scope of the bill, aspects of the extraterritorial applications of this bill, and constitutional difficulties around the legal certainty and capability of enforcement of some criminal offences contained in the bill. The political effects of the bill are also an important consideration for this House. Ireland has a stronger voice and greater influence on Middle East issues generally at UN and EU level than our size alone would normally justify. That is where we are able to be most helpful to the Palestinian people, which is my priority. Indeed, both Israeli and Palestinian people, in helping to achieve a just and lasting peace. My fear is that if Ireland adopts this bill, we would be choosing to be a principled voice, yes, satisfied in the righteousness of our own course, but largely unable to influence the real action. I am in no doubt from my experience of discussions on this issue at EU level that a unilateral move by Ireland on this matter would weaken our ability to influence overall EU policy, not strengthen it. If we allow ourselves to be discounted on the calculations that other states make about where the centre of gravity in Middle East policy lies, then we cease to shape the central gravity of that position. The third basis on which the government must oppose the bill is the assessment of its practical effects, including practical challenges and cost of compliance for Irish companies which trade internationally. For example, US companies in Ireland and Irish companies in the US could be placed in an impossible conflict of jurisdictions. Legislation was under discussion in the United States Congress in 2018 to forbid companies based in the US from cooperating with trade bans on Israel and Israeli settlements. Such proposals have enjoyed strong cross-party support in the US, so such legislation may well be passed into law. Similar legislation already exists at state level in many US states. Irish missions and state agencies in the US have already received queries from companies concerned about this impact of the bill and the lack of clarity on their legal obligations. This bill is a sincere attempt, in my view, to address a real issue. And I want to recognise that, and also recognise Senator Frances Black, who began the journey of this bill. If enacted, it would, of course, provide a moment of solace for Palestinians at a very difficult time. But in my view, the solace would only be momentary. Legislation must be designed by the head as well as by the heart. And it is the job of any government to assess the balance of possibilities, positives and negatives, of any policy option. The bill before us will not significantly impact on Israeli settlements, in my view. Conversely, it will place Ireland in breach of EU law. That alone should be enough to make it impossible to vote for it. But it will also lead to Ireland facing legal challenge and the strong likelihood of very significant penalties, as well as being obliged to repeal the law and possibly pay damages to those with economic interests in settlements. It will diminish Ireland's influence on behalf of the Palestinians at EU level, which is my main concern. And it will create difficulties for Ireland and for companies in Ireland with compliance, including with US legislation. Ultimately, despite being well and sincerely intentioned by its original authors, this bill will do serious damage to Ireland and bring only momentary consolation to Palestinians, and we owe them more than that. For these reasons, no responsible political party of government could support this bill, and this government must and will oppose it.
Romagad, we now move to the